What's become of words and text in a visual world is a question posed by the New York Times in May of this year. Have words and text, as suggested, been turned into mere accessories? According to the article, with more pictures, fewer words, text is losing clout with an image-hungry audience constantly searching for, posting, and reposting photos. Everyone is in an archival roller coaster of process of picture language. That roller coaster is also gobbling up the language of poetry, now coming to terms with the ever more democratized and recent arrival of video poetry. The power of image, in particular moving images, in collaboration with words, has unleashed an avalanche of new media artists, of video poets, who have let loose a jumble of poetic text, sound, and images on our omnipresent computer screens. As Mitchell Stevens in The Rise of Image, The Fall of Word says, this new art form currently is in the process of being born, is feeling its way toward a new relationship with words, sound, and each other, where highly kinetic moving images reimagine, not merely recreate the world. As a poet teaching in an art college for the last 20 years, I've had an abiding interest in the relation between word and image. However, since 2004, when I began to practice videography myself with some seriousness, I've had an ongoing ambiguity in my work about how image and text, voice, interact on the moving screen. So the theme of this conference, Word Image, has given me the right opportunity to explore what has been lurking in my thoughts and underpinning my work now for at least 8 years. My ideas on this are driven by two sources. One is a statement by the then chair of Department of Illustration at Ringling, Tom Kasmer, who remarked to me once that any good illustration of a text does not repeat in visual language the literalness of the story it illustrates, but rather takes the opportunity to expand imaginatively on the words. And secondly, an edict by Tom Conavese, who has been called a video poetry pioneer because he's credited with coining the term video poetry in 1982. And is the first person to produce a manifesto in 2011 on what constitutes a video poem. In his manifesto, Conavese claims that any image on the screen should not capture words in a literal sense, but allow for a space to imaginatively build on those ideas. He says, to see an image as a representation of the audible text, or to hear the words as they are displayed on the screen, violates the premise that poetic juxtaposition is the presentation of distant realities. Inevitably, the viewer is prevented from forming their own imaginative associations between the elements presented, resulting in the demystification of these associations, diminishing the poetic quality and experience of the work. While I agree with the concept these words suggest, I also know that the juxtaposition of image in ways that are at odds significantly with what's being spoken or written on the screen can easily become nothing more than a discombobulated mess. No need to reinvent surrealism or dadaism in video poetry. The clearer the semantics, either visual or verbal, of a video poem, the better the poetic experience becomes. For example, one of the early experimenters with this form is Billy Collins, a recent poet laureate of the U.S. He has collaborated with various media artists to illustrate on the screen the presentation of his poems. They're typically cleverly done by accomplished media artists and do create an intriguing showing of his poems. One of his better-known pieces, The Dead, which is animated by Juan Delkin, has cartoon figures enacting the words of the text while it is read out loud. This poem draws the audience into an unusual space where the dead become alive, so to speak, on the screen and grab the viewer's full attention as the poem unfolds.
The dead are always looking down on us, they say. While we are putting on our shoes or making a sandwich, they are looking down through the glass-bottom boats of heaven as they row themselves slowly through eternity. They watch the tops of our heads moving below on earth, and when we lie down in a field or on a couch, drugged perhaps by the hum of a warm afternoon, they think we are looking back at them, which makes them lift their oars and fall silent and wait, like parents, for us to close our eyes.
Ron Silliman, poet and recognized weblogger of the site of poetry, says of Billy Collins' work, The Dead. Neither poem nor cartoon threatened to break any new ground whatsoever. It's nothing more than a reading of the piece over which a cartoon has been superimposed. As simple a premise as this poem has, and as literal a rendering as the animation provides, I have to disagree with Silliman, and by extension, Conavese, on the nothing more premise. Collins's use of animation in translating The Dead into a visual language goes a long ways to enhance the viewer's or the reader's experience of the original text. The goal Conavese has of making video poems a literary genre in their own right has in some ways brought about an ineffectual distinction, which excludes a wealth of forms not in concert with his limited definition. For him, the only legitimate video poetry is a construct that augments the suggestive power of poetry by unexpected juxtapositions. It cannot simply demystify a poem by the use of complementary visuals. Such a distinction seems overly restrictive, particularly in light of Conavese's own video poems, where the unexpected juxtapositions of the visuals could use a bit of remystifying of their own. For example, in his video poem, Poems for the Rivers Project, Conavese states on his YouTube posting of it, in the summer of 2003, my 18-year-old son Alexander was working for a rivers project at the Surrey Art Gallery. He kept pestering me to submit a poem. I wrote a 13-line poem, which we posited over Alex's abstract water-related images, all sustained by the drone of an unrelenting didgeridoo. The poetic narrative is resolved by a verbo-visual pun on the underside of the Alex Fraser Bridge. It's a 2-minute piece that is hard to attend to for its full duration. The abstraction of the water and splash images, which are lovely in themselves, are not supported by an interesting enough poetic text to carry the piece for that long. The poem reads, "Never step into the same river twice. Twice searching for answers on the shore in the cool moonlight, time stands still. It's all right now to cross, I hear him whisper, and I believe him, even when the rush I feel translates as my blood, and the bridge of these lines is pronounced Alex Fraser Bridge." For me, there are no clear, unexpected juxtapositions in this work, regardless of the fact that the water and its splashes become abstract. Never mind that the verbo-visual pun is comparatively literal in itself, brings us back to the literal, rather than creating for us some other universe. On the plus side, Conavese's manifesto addresses three facets of video poetry: its definition, its constraints, and its categories. He defines video poetry as a genre of poetry displayed on a screen, distinguished by its time-based, poetic juxtaposition of images with text and sound. In the measured blending of these three elements, image, text, and sound, it produces in the viewer the realization of a poetic experience. Fair enough. This definition arguably covers the base as well. Of a video poem's constraints, Conavese writes, text displayed on screen or voiced is an essential element of the video poem. A work which does not contain visible or audible text could be described as poetic, as an art film, or video art, but not as a video poem. Imagery in a video poem, including on-screen text, does not illustrate the voice text. But perhaps there is a broader notion of the term illustration to be considered than the one Conavese suggests here, for it is one which his work does not always clearly support. The fact of the matter is, the multiple permutations of the use of sound, text, and image create a vast array of choices by which to layer a video poem. The categories of video poems that Conavese identifies in his manifesto include the following five: cinepoetry, which is a video poem where the text is animate or superimposed over graphics, still or moving images. For example, Bridget Lowe's The Pilgrim is Bridled and Bespectacled.
I take you to the desert where we will shrivel like worms and become tongues for other people to kiss with. World, there are two baskets on my back. Fill them. Fill them with fruit and more fruit.
Or the second one is performance poetry, which is the on-screen appearance of the poet speaking directly or indirectly into the camera. As an example, Saul Williams said the shotgun to the head excerpt.
The basis of Isis cross-faded to Ankh. The beat drops like a cliff overlooking my heart. 6,000 feet above sea level. 3,300 bodies disassembled, the head bones connected to the cockpit, knee-jerk-ass backwards dancing slaves in a mosh pit, punk rock of Gibraltar roll out, nothing's new, more blood dyes the mohawk, only this time it's you, and you never loved her for what she possessed, you powdered her face and came on her headdress, oil-slicked feathers, putrid stench, waterbed, mother nature's a whore, said the shotgun to the head.
Thirdly, there's visual text, which displays text on screen superimposed over images. An example of this is Vangelis Kouros's I, Poem 6. Fourthly, there's sound text, which presents text on a soundtrack juxtaposed over video images on the screen. It is expressed through the human voice. For example, John Ashbery's Paradoxes and Oxymorons.
This poem is concerned with language on a very plain level. Look at it talking to you. You look out a window or pretend to fidget. You have it, but you don't have it. You miss it, it misses you. You miss each other. The poem is sad because it wants to be yours and cannot. What's a plain level? It is that and other things, bringing a system of them into play. Play? Well, actually, yes. But I consider play to be a deeper outside thing, a dreamed role pattern, as if the division of grace these long August days, without proof, open-ended. And before you know, it gets lost in the stream and chatter of typewriters. It has been played once more. I think you exist only to tease me into doing it on your level, and then you aren't there, or have adopted a different attitude. And the poem has set me softly down beside you. The poem is you.
And the last example is kinetic text, which is the animation of text over a neutral background. For example, Eric Gunzweig's A Few Good Men.
If you gave an order, that Santiago wasn't to be touched. And your orders are always followed. And why would Santiago be in danger? Why would it be necessary to transfer him off the base?
The usefulness of these distinctions begs the issue of how one can best convey meaning through the layering of text, sound, and image. It is all poetry on screen, juxtaposed over other media. The more interesting question is what works and why. And what ways of layering image, sound, and text create a richer, more enhanced poetic experience for the viewer, the reader, than the written text alone can. Of these categories of video poetry, the most obvious translation from one art form to another by simply recording an event is the performance poetry. But there's a lot to be said for observing the poet performing his or her own work. The drama, the tonal intonations, the rhythms, all come across audibly with indispensable clarity and do indeed enhance a poetic experience. Not to have heard Gertrude Stein or Ezra Pound or Saul Williams or Allen Ginsberg recite their own poems is to miss an essential quality of their work, as I imagine it would have been also with Homer's recitations had his work been written down while he lived. So viewing the poet reciting his or her work does add an essential quality to the poetic experience, as does the layering of other sound or text with visual images, even if slightly less so. That said, these distinctions for me are more taxonomic than useful in relation to unpacking a poem. For the premise of this line of reasoning hinges on whether one views the inception of video poetry as residing originally in the visual or in the verbal medium. As a poet, when I began experimenting with the hybrid genre, it was as a way to enhance my poems and to engage the audience on another level. A way to draw their attention while I surreptitiously inundated their auditory senses with words. I thought of it as sneaking up on the listener with language while they were otherwise engaged in a visual experience. I have since come to recognize that sustaining the undivided attention of the viewer, the listener, is only part of the creative endeavor. There's also the challenge of creating an open space that engages multiple points of view while perception and comprehension intermingle in a montage of meanings. If it can do that, then it has risen to the challenge of video poetry as a genre in its own right. But this is not quite as simple as you, as we might think. What's right about Canova's visual-verbal rapport in video poetry is that the work, the hybrid, is rooted in the imagination, in Earthona, in the Blakeian sense of the word, as earth owner. The work itself hinges on metaphor, on symbol, on image, both visual and verbal. Perception, that which goes by fast, is all image, and it keeps going by, it never stops, and thus the world of spirit does talk with us, and we do hear it, and sometimes when we don't deny or hide from it, it comes sailing like wind through on the stream of image. The relation of word, text, sound to moving image, that is narrative, melody, sequential time, and a still image, that is symbol, a codified slice of life, plus the effect that differing, even opposing ways of layering image, text, and sound have on the poetic experience, belies the open nature of the hybrid beast, video poetry. There are a number of choices, for instance, videos where images don't match words, but don't necessarily interfere with the verbal vector either. Take Anne Carson's first lines in Reticent Sonnet as an example, where she says, "A pronoun is a kind of withdrawing from naming, because naming is heavy." How do you visualize this line? What does a pronoun look like on the screen, on the page? What does naming look like? What images would come to mind were you to frame an image with these words? That Anne Carson, in this instance, chooses dance as image, chooses the moving body to articulate the words, does not interfere with the verbal intent, whatever it may be, or however you may choose to read these lines. The body movement does focus our minds to a narrow slice of awareness, and the words that follow roll over us as a rolling pin does dough. Or you might find a video poem where a love poem is cast in the voice of a surveillance satellite, like I Spy by Martha McCullough. The viewer is immediately drawn into the universe, created by the blue cast of the background and the white machine-made circles and lines swamping the screen. It's mesmerizing, like a clock is when you can't sleep. In experiencing the whole of the video poem, the viewer listener becomes a willing participant in suspending disbelief. It all happens and is real because the visually fascinating, constantly morphing scenes hold on to their blue insistence as clocks and boxes and circles and propellers float, drift, or fly by. What is created by the visual composite is a tone that effortlessly sustains the words voiced over in robotic form. The ensuing experience of the video poem creates a cognitive pleasure, which may be one obvious offshoot of the intersection of image and word. Is this something we should exclude from the video poem label? Or you may come across a video poem where the images are vaguely similar to the vocalizations, as in Aaron Fagan's My Entrepreneurial Spirit.
My entrepreneurial spirit. While there are parts of me I cannot put my finger on, I grow touched that I know I don't know who I am, fighting against all the thoughts I keep in time. Kindred with space, my infinite feelings fall out.
In this work, the frames of objects suggested by the spoken words appear also in the evolving image stream. They are not exact, but they are not off enough to throw the receiving mind into a quandary. The puzzle instead becomes the intent of the words, which seem to be saying something that wants very much to be heard. Another type of video poem I've uncovered is one that encourages silence, one that creates gaps between words and which may suggest intention and no words. In Aaron Fagan's Naked Leaf Dissolve, for example, there's a long opening silence on the screen with only the image of a man walking in snow along a long vertically barred metal fence. Halfway through the entire length of the video poem, which is 3 minutes long, the man stops, turns to the camera, slightly off full frontal, and reads a poem with sound effects overlaid so that occasionally they drown out the words. The listener must struggle to hear and wonders about the need. The message is as much in the silences and in the noise as in the words. And yet when the words do shine through, they have a breathtaking intensity and depth to them. All of these video poems remind me why I'm repeatedly drawn to this hybrid genre. It's not to digest a specific complex of word image as its maker may or may not have intended, and it's not to measure it against a specifically defined form in its outrush. Rather, it's to relish the change of mind that comes from unpacking a loaded video poem, from discerning its innermost tenets to uncovering its convoluted architecture whose image and word edifices appear at unexpected moments and feed into the harvesting of my own imagination. as Megan Snyderkamp says of John Ashbery's poems in general. Work in that context, the work of bridging gaps, navigating a sharp turn, weighing one thing against another, feels like play. I get lost in it. I resurface. I dive back down. I show up muddy to lunch. I'm not trying to get exactly out of the poem what the poet put in. I'm certain that I won't. What I get, rather, is specifically what I need, which shifts with each reading. Or shifts with each viewing, could be said. Likewise, the work of a well-hewn video poem is to open connections between our senses, between the visual and the auditory, that veer us toward an immenseness of possibility.